and see how it can be extended. After all, those young people haven't been found guilty of a crime, and they shouldn't be there for any more than a short period, if at all.
What is your observation about how well or otherwise people get on in the aftermath of spending time in Overstown?
Actually, I don't have the figures here, but I do know that there is a high level of recidivism, that we often see young people who have been in Overstown two or three times before, and many of them do unfortunately go on to enter prison. And I think that is why that the detention schools were set up, was to prevent that happening, to provide young people with an alternative where they could attend school in a stable place where there are therapeutic supports for them as needed. And I think that if they could get over what's happening now, that they could address those issues and look at better outcomes for those young people in a situation where it is a caring environment that is not focused on sanction and containment. And I think that is where everybody wants it to go.
Right, we'll leave it there for now. Jennifer Garrigan, thanks for coming in, Director and Chief Executive of EPIC, that's Empowering Young People in Care. We'll be talking about how it'll soon be possible, or soon may be possible, to get to different law firms to bid for your business. That's after the break.
Today with Sean O'Rourke on RTE Radio 1.
The only other new TX range, the best clubs we've ever made at Tour Max. They're probably the best clubs ever made. Featuring a unique dual cavity design, the TX series deliver even better control and feel. And the lighter, deeper forged titanium head means you can generate faster club head speed for even glue. Aren't there much better ways to blow €1,000 than paying a TV license fine? Remember, if you have a TV, you need a TV license. It's the law. To get yours, visit tvlicense.ie. Give your kid the X Factor with the TX series only from Tour Max.
Right, so in other words, because it lets people contact solicitors and get prices for their work in advance. Now, is that something that you felt or have discovered that people have not been able to do up to now?
Unfortunately, what was happening was, and obviously being in the legal profession myself just over a decade now, I was listening to my clients who often told me when they came for initial interviews that for them to try and ascertain any kind of service from a solicitor, they had to log on to Google, put down their search into the search engines, and then they would get a list of solicitors, then they would have to individually ring each solicitor up, try and make an appointment, then go to the high street. It was a lot of arduous, let's just say, hassle for the clients. And this was really listening to my clients, and I thought, well, clearly there's a gap in the market here.
How many solicitors have you got using or at least responding to this service and this need as you've identified it so far?
As of today, we're coming to 62 solicitors so far, and that's in 6 weeks.
Right, so it's I suppose you could say it's a slow build. We're talking about the United Kingdom, 62 firms to date. What does the service cost them? I presume they have to pay you a fee.
Yes, it's an annual subscription. However, the introductory, we offer an introductory matter. The first one is free, and then if they like the service, then they can opt to subscribe. I mean, it is a nominal fee. It's a $295, say, for five cases for the year, or 10 cases, which is $495, and then we do bespoke packages for firms that have multiple multiple offices up and down the country.
So the cost obviously lies with the solicitor and not the customer for the service as you're providing it. And what about the level of interest by the public and people with cases that they want to get quotes for?
That's been overwhelming. That's exceeded our expectations. And all we need now is to get as many solicitors on board, really. I mean, there's a huge demand for low bid.
Yeah, but do you want to put numbers on the number of people who come on with their
as of today, we're nearing 300 people.
Right, and so they come along, they set out the facts of the case, and they presumably have an outcome that they want, or at least that they want initially, they want advice. Is that how it works?
That's right, quite right. And they simply go to the articulator what the issue is, and then if the solicitor hopefully should have the specialism, will then be in contact with the individual to say this is how much either it will cost, or the solicitor may give an hourly rate, and then the client or the potential client has then the option of choosing that solicitor, or either the price or the locality of the solicitor, or it may be that they've read a review from a previous user. So it just gives more choice, really.
So you could have everything from, I suppose, a murder case to you might have a row with your neighbour, you could have an unfair dismissal issue or something like that, but people have to put this information online now. I mean, again, I suppose once you put something online, you might have a question of confidentiality. At least if you're sitting down with a lawyer in the privacy of an office, you could talk something through. Maybe there might even be an initial fee for the first encounter, and it just stays in the room. Whereas, you know, it's you put it online in whatever system is used, and you wonder, well, where is this going to end up?
Yeah, no, I mean I'm glad that you raised that, Sean. It's a secure portal, and when you put information on, we do check before we broadcast that case to the lawyers. So we would check to make sure that any sensitive information there gets removed. However, it is a secure portal. It only goes to the solicitors, who are bound by confidentiality anyway. So nobody else would know other than the individual and the lawyer that accepts to take it on.
Now, you have a plan, I think it's next month, early next month, to launch this service in Ireland. How are you going about that?
I've got a small team here working on that. Scotland and Ireland, and towards the end of the year we're aiming to go to UAE, i.e.
interested in it so far?
No. The idea is once we've launched, when we get the cases from Ireland, we will make contact with the solicitors to say we have a case for them to take on.
Okay, well, look, we'll keep an eye on it and see how it goes. Just one thing, I mean, like the fact that you might get it, you might get the cheapest offer doesn't necessarily mean you'll get the best service, does it?
That's right. That's why, I mean, it's left to the client as to choose which solicitor to go with. Now, many clients may, price may be the only factor, but there'll be other clients who would want a solicitor who the closest, say, within the vicinity of where they live, or it may be that they've seen comments from other clients. They might be service that they're after, and price isn't a factor, but the beauty of Lopin is it gives you a choice to the degree you want. Whereas before it was the case of having to log on to Google and phone every single solicitor, which would take a long time. So this is really just to simplify the whole procedure.
Kid Harwood, thank you very much indeed for joining us. And that's Kid Harwood, Director of Wilding Solicitors and CEO of Lopin. Lost and stolen property piling up in Garda stations after the break.
Today with Sean O'Rourke on RTE Radio 1. RTE Radio 1.
Danny Knickerbocker Gloria here, just letting you know that the boys in green will soon be seen. This ain't Stephen's Green for the best panto there's ever been.
Yes, it's Robin Hood and his Merry Men. This year's fabulous panto at the Gaiety Theatre from November 27th.
Don't be disappointed.
Here, now tell me about the office here.
Yeah, this is our what we call our PEM store, our property exhibit management office.
Garda, Yvonne Edelman looks after the public here.
Are items coming in here every day?
Yeah, in the last year we've had 600 items of property handed into this Garda station alone. The vast majority of what we get handed in are smaller items, the likes of wallets, phones, keys, small pieces of clothing and that kind of thing.
And it's the Monday morning when you get the most of them after the weekend?
Monday, Tuesday morning after a bank holiday. December would also be extremely popular months. People off Christmas parties would often tend to lose things a bit more. But we've had some very strange items handed in. We've had Zimmer frames, mannequins.
Mannequins,
yes.
What's the story with that?
I don't know. I don't think I want to know. anything. You could literally come in here and I would be prams, buggies. I'm only short of finding a child in a pram one of these days.
Garda Yvonne Edelman there. I don't think I want to know about mannequins either. And after I spoke to Garda Yvonne Edelman there, we went and looked at a sample of the items that had been handed in. And you got a sense of just some of the items that they held there over a longer period of time as well in their property.
So this is the interim store. This is where property is placed when it's handed in to the Garda station. So here we have an example of what's been handed in thus far this month. So this is just for the weekend. So we have a suitcase, guitar, we have a backpack with a MacBook, we have a number of telephones, three telephones, a set of keys, a wallet, and some items of clothing. Everything here came in through taxis at the weekend, we're on it. We'll do everything we can to get them back to the owner. Obviously, you know, that's ideal for us. We'd love to get everything back to the owner 100%. The likes of the MacBook and that kind of thing with serial numbers, we will seek the assistance of Apple. We'll send an email over to the States and they will contact the owner, hopefully, if it's registered. And that's what we urge people to do, is to register as much of their property as possible. If you have a UV pen, make sure you put your contact number or your AirPod number onto your property. Onto the item. That would also be a great assistance to us. Again, make sure that your LEAP cards and stuff are registered with LEAP cards. They can also assist us. Take a photo of items, take a photo of the serial number.
Okay, so this is the stuff that's just come in this weekend. The other thing maybe you might show me, maybe have them outside, is bicycles. There seems to be a big increase in the number of bicycles being stolen, is there?
There's an increase in bicycles. We recover a lot of bicycles here throughout the whole Dublin City. Unfortunately, some people may not have a description of their bicycle. They may not have the serial number. Ultimately, if they're not recovered, they are auctioned off.
It's very expensive bicycles people are cycling around in at the moment.
Yes, we had a case there in the city centre there in recent weeks where a German tourist had a bicycle stolen. It was something €10,000. Thankfully, that was recovered. You know, people have to buy very expensive bikes and then a very cheap lock. You know, we recommend like a good locking system for your bicycle, you know, and put park in a place where maybe cameras to watch it there.
Wow, Brian, $10,000 for a bike, that is quite something.
Yeah, and they had dozens and dozens of bicycles outside in the shed in Irish Town. Some clearly were very new, some very expensive types, and many of them with very flimsy chain locks, I have to say. And as they said there, those chain locks are very easily snipped open. So they were recommending the stronger U-type locks. And again, as you heard from Superintendent Jerry Delmar there, be very careful where you lock your bike.
Now, mention there, Brian, of items being auctioned off if they're not reclaimed.
Yeah, all the items are put up on the Garda system, but if they're not reclaimed, auctions are held through auction houses and sold off. Generally, over the course of a year, well over €50,000 is raised this way, and I'm told if you know what you're looking for, you can get a pretty good bargain at these auctions. I look back at some of the figures in 2009, close to €129,000 was raised through these auctions of unclaimed property, and the money does go straight back into the exchequer.
So Brian, finally, mannequins aside, you wanted to have a quick look at some of the stranger items left in taxis or found by members of the public.
These are items that may end up being auctioned off. They've probably been there over a month anyway, so for several months. And I started by asking, how long do they hold items before selling them off?
We keep it for a year. Yeah, we keep it for a year. And during that time, you know, and we have it, probably will be put onto our website, the Garda website.
I have to laugh because there's a Zimmer frame here about 2 feet away from you and a chainsaw on the left hand. Please tell me that. And on top of a wheelchair, I didn't even see the wheelchair. So with a Zimmer frame, a wheelchair and a chainsaw, I hope they weren't left at the same time.
The Zimmer frame was, but the wheelchair was found in the shopping centre, in the nearby shopping centre. But stolen property can come anywhere. We have had property reunited with people that live in Europe. this is all subject to the charge. These will be exhibits for court. These will be property that we would have recovered, that will be required for court for prosecutions. So again, you know, apart from reuniting people with their property, if we recover property on suspected criminals, we can successfully prosecute them people if people have their property identified, if we can reunite the property.
Okay, so I'm just looking around here, there's a nice set of golf clubs there, handbag, Tommy Hilfiger handbag.
We have an auctioneer that's contracted on behalf of Garcia, and they will auction the property off every so often. They will have auctions, and all property coming into possession of Garcia on it that we cannot reunite with owners is auctioned off.
So that's Superintendent Jerry Delmar there. Brian, trust you to spot those golf clubs. Now, we mentioned at the start about this, I think it's rather clumsily titled, Garda National Recovered Day on Thursday.
Yeah, it's a bit awkwardly titled, isn't it? As I said, there are going to be several designated stations around the country open to the public this Thursday, and you can go in and view whatever items they have. There's a full list of which stations are opened on the Garda website, www.garda.ie. And, for example, a lot of the items held in Irish Towns will be on view in Pierce Street. You can also view them online, as I said, on Thursday by going to the Garda website. And then if you're interested in buying some of those unclaimed items, like the Tommy Hilfiger bag I thought might make a nice Christmas present, those auctions are listed on the Garda website also, so keep an eye on that.
And Brian, it's a matter of interest, how do they spot people who might chance their arm and say, oh look, you know, I lost a bicycle, there it is at the back of the shed?
Very, very difficult to prove. So if you have a picture on your mobile phone of yourself up on top of the bicycle, that might help. If you have the serial number, they're going to ask for proof, obviously, and that's why they were saying try and take pictures of your items and at least just store them, if not on your phone, on the cloud somewhere, so that if your phone is taken, you have some record of your attachment to the item.
Brian, thanks indeed for that report. Brian O'Connor reporting. We'll be talking sport, particularly the All-Ireland drawn All-Ireland football final at Croke Park yesterday. That's after this show.
Today with Sean O'Rourke on RTE Radio 1.
This sounds a bit daft, man. You could have said it like this, but it's nice to see you. I mean, it's nice to have you back.
See yourself in the mirror, not your psoriasis. Dovonex psoriasis ointment can help you see a difference in your psoriasis in as early as 2 weeks, and now it's available direct from your pharmacist. So at the first sign of a flare-up, try Dovonex psoriasis ointment and love your skin again. Contains calcipotrol for mild to moderate plaque psoriasis diagnosed by a doctor. Always read the label.
Dispiace.
Verzeihung.
Verbatch me.
Lo siento.
Disculpa.
Pritschke.
Never enough after a death on our roads. Sign the pledge at disable.org and help us make the 21st of September the European Day Without a Road Death. From the Road Safety Authority and Garda Síochána.
RTE Radio 1.
I'm Bear Grylls, and this year I'm taking on my greatest challenge ever, a live theatrical spectacular like you've never seen before.
Bear Grylls presents Endeavour. New adventure awaits October 19th through your arena.
Using cutting-edge video mapping technology, daring stunts and audience participation to put you at the heart of the action.
Tickets available now.
Endeavour, the live arena spectacular.
Entertainment updates with RTE Radio 1. Watch us live now at rte.ie/todaysor.
Play it again, Sam, or at least play it again for Sam. So they have to do it all again on Saturday, the 1st of October, after Dublin and Mayo played out a thrilling, if not a particularly high quality, according to some of the experts, All-Ireland final yesterday. Here to analyse that match and other big stories from a weekend of sport are Charlie Redmond, All-Ireland winning Dublin forward, and John Mullen, three times All-Ireland finalist as a manager of Mayo, sports writer Marlon Bannon, and Damien Lawler, presenter of RTE's GAA podcast, Jones's Road. Orla, I suppose, as the objective Ulster voice and viewer yesterday and observer, what would you say to the word ugly if you had to use one word to summarise that match?
Ugly. I mean, it was such a disappointment. I know conditions were terrible, very, very difficult. I'm sure the guys would agree. But even allowing for that, there was so many mistakes. You know, the conditions don't excuse sort of some of the mistakes we saw, particularly in the first half. The amount of people that were caught in possession, turned over. You know, that's just maybe a lack of concentration, nerves, whatever it was. But you'd have to say that Mayo to concede those two young goals, I mean, we've never seen anything like it. It was unbelievable. Like, but for to come back from that, you know, they could easily have said, like, yet again, it's not our day. But, you know, they fought back very well. So even though it was a poor game, so much improvement by both sides. And although neither side, you could say, deserved to lose, I don't think either of them deserved to win either.
Another word you could use about it, Damien, thrilling.
It was intense. It was a defender's day, I thought. And when, like Orla said, when those two own goals went in, I was just thinking of witches and witchcraft and voodoo dolls and some curse that some poor Mayo person incurred years ago, because I just said, how in the name of God are they going to come back from that? But they did. It showed great heart and it showed great belief. And I don't think Dublin played well yesterday. But I thought it was thrilling in a different way, Sean. It wasn't the classic scorching encounter, but it was never going to be. But it was dogged and it was ferocious. I saw the hits fairly close up now, and it was a good game to watch.
Yeah, and I was just looking at Kieran Whelan, Charlie Ireland, your former teammate on the Sunday game last night, saying, Mayo left her behind with there today, you know. I wonder, was that a bit smug on his part?
Possibly, yeah. I think it'll be a most debated topic during the week. Didn't Mayo leave it behind? They came yesterday with a great game plan, with a great intensity, and they performed really well. They scored 2:15, two goals for us, so they scored 2:15 and yesterday, and they still couldn't beat us.
But, I mean...
That's a bit more than old Charlie. But I said all last week that Mayo would have to score more goals than Dublin to win. I was right, but I was wrong.
Yeah. John Maughan, again, it was one of those things, like, there's an awful lot for Mayo to take from this. First of all, to come back from the two own goals, right? To come back and score, to be 5 points down, was it at halftime? And literally at the stroke of full time almost on the clock before added time was put into the things, to be 3 points down. Yeah, still be standing.
I thought Sean they displayed remarkable resilience and character, and there was a manliness about Mayo yesterday that I haven't witnessed in recent times. They were absolutely tuned to perfection. Yes, it wasn't a classic, and invariably you don't get these classic encounters in All-Ireland finals. The conditions obviously didn't help in that regard, but we had a dramatic game, and Kenny O'Connor had nerves of steel. He showed wonderful character to kick that equalising point. And there's a debate around the 7 minutes of extra time, what should there have been. I think there was 11 substitutions in the second half alone. Give an average of 30-35 seconds for those substitutes. That's 7 minutes alone, not accounting for the bit of gamesmanship that goes on and injuries, etc. So I think, as Orla rightly said, I don't think any team deserved to lose that game. I think a draw probably was a fair result, and let's go at it again.
I'm looking at the markings that were allocated by Tony Lean in the Examiner. He marks it 106 to 104 in favour of the Dubs, whereas Colm Keyes in the Independent, as far as any of these things matter, as they marks it 104 to 99 for Mayo. But an awful lot of those players, Charlie Redmond, those Dublin players, certainly the forwards, they didn't live up to expectations. Talk to me about the free taking as well with Dean Rock, because that's an area you should be very familiar with.
It's always exceptionally difficult on a wet surface like that to kick the ball from the ground, and most of the free throws that probably to John outside were from a bit of a distance there, where you have to get a little bit of weight into the ball, and that makes it, that increases the danger of you losing your footing, and your contact with the ball is never as good as you'd like. He's an exceptional young man. He's playing very well all year. Yesterday probably wasn't his best day ever, but come here, there was an awful lot of fellas yesterday on that field who didn't live up to the high level they've set in the past, and I'm sure with the performance of both Paul Mannion and Paddy Andrews when they come on, they'll all be looking over the shoulder for the next day.
Damien, you, John and I happened to be at an event in the Gresham for the NUI Galway alumni, and yeah. Bomber Liston was there giving some really interesting insights into what can happen to people as they get on in their careers. The kind of accepted wisdom would be, look, you, the experience stands to you, you can handle things more readily. He actually was saying the reverse is the case, and I'm wondering if that might have affected, or that phenomenon might have affected or infected some of the dogs.
Bomber was making the point yesterday morning that his first All-Ireland final was the easiest for him because he didn't really know what faced him, but as he went on in his career, even though he won so much, I suppose that the mental struggle of what faced him and the enormity of the occasion kind of hit him. And I think there's no doubt that maybe that and the weather conditions yesterday, you know, added up to maybe some players not being able to contribute to their best. One guy I feel sorry for is Kevin McMenamin. It's his first time starting an All-Ireland final, first time getting behind the Artane Boys Parade, and I thought he was taken off quite early. I thought one or two others could have gone before him, John.
Yeah, we certainly discussed that after the game. You know, Bernard Brogan hasn't lived up to, you know, the very high standards as he set for himself over the past couple of years. Jim O'Connell, it was always a fascinating battle when Mayo played Dublin. Obviously, Lee Keegan and Jim O'Connell have a box off, and they did again yesterday. They didn't disappoint in that regard. And it's fascinating just to watch that encounter, that duel alone. But when Jim doesn't play with that, and to his high standards, like, I mean, that normally has a significant effect on the Dublin performance. Paul Flynn, is it a theory surrounding maybe is he injured or is he not? Look, as we just mentioned there, it wasn't a day for forwards. Those conditions were exceptionally difficult. We were sitting in the stand and some of us that were nice and dry couldn't understand how difficult it was to play there. We saw that with the minors as well, slipping and sliding. So as Damien said there, it was a defender's day yesterday, and I thought the Mayo defence was absolutely awesome in that department.
And all I suppose, Jerome Connolly had a bit of a box off with Kieran Kilkenny at the end as well about what should happen that sideline.
Yeah, that's right. I mean,
a critical moment, one of many, I suppose, in the course of the game.
One of many. I mean, but he's you know, been able to be very accurate from those situations in the past. So you can't blame him for wanting to have a go. I mean, we can all sit back in hindsight, and you know, all the players will wake up this morning thinking, if I had done A, B, or C, there would have been a different outcome. So I don't think anyone in Dublin will criticise him for that.
Charlie, Jack O'Connor in the Examiner analysis piece he has written for today says that he'll be watching to see, will Jim Gavin and the backroom team, will they drop both Paul Flynn and Bernard Brogan from the starting 15 on the 1st of October?
I wouldn't know, to be honest, at the moment. We were talking about outside again. Will he show the loyalty to the players that the players have shown to him, or will he introduce other guys? I think Kevin was taken off because he had a yellow card. And I was saying, that game was made for Kevin.
Nice man.
He was taken off because of the yellow card. I think Jim feared that something else was going to happen, but that game was made for him. He's small, he's robust, he's strong, and he's fast. And when he gets going in the last 10 minutes of the game, that's when he's going to pull a few frees, make a few breakthroughs, and get a couple of points.
Paddy Andrews start for him, though, Charlie?
Well, I think Paddy Andrews will probably come in. Who he comes in for would be debated.
And it has to be a strong case for Paul Mannion as well to start for the Dubs.
I have to say, I think it would be easy for Mayo to beat that Dublin team from yesterday, but I don't think that's the Dublin team that will start in the replay. I mean, I was sorry to see him get a black card yesterday, but when you see the likes of Paddy Andrews coming on, and Dublin hadn't scored until the 30th or 31st minute, and seeing Paddy Andrews bombing two wonderful points over the bar, you have to make a very strong argument for him. Paul Mannion, as you rightly say, Ola Garra is another that has hurt Mayo defenders in the past. I mean, they have enormous resources, but as Charlie said to me outside, you can only start 15 at any one time.
The one thing we do know for sure, whether Jim Gavin, whatever his decision is, none of us will know about it. He'll name the same team. He'll name an unchanged team. It's like the big, you know, a massive bugbear among our colleagues in the media, Damien, isn't it? The way, you know, these teams that are named and then all the changes at the last minute. So you can expect unchanged teams to be announced during the week.
Well, yes, I think
2 minutes.
I think yesterday both teams lined out.
The programme was accurate for three.
I think the way around that is just to have squad numbers at the start of the season and release the squad list in every programme. And then I don't think it makes a difference, Damien, though, when it comes to the final. These guys, two teams, that in the last six encounters, two wins apiece, two draws, to know each other exceptionally well. There is no mystery surrounding who starts or who finishes. Right. We know exactly what they have, the resources they have.
Yeah, but if he's going to drop a Bernard Brogan, for instance, he's not going to want 2 days of commentary on that in the media. That decision, we will know about that 2 minutes before.
The inter-county footballers all don't read the papers about the games.
I think Seamus O'Shea was singled out for a bit of criticism that he was replaced, and maybe it should have happened a bit earlier than it was yesterday.
Yeah, I'll just say, Martin, I know we were rather frustrated. I think Seamus had four consecutive turnovers. The red mist had come down, and I don't know what happened. Was it fatigue? And look at it was. In that regard, Sean, it was a very, very difficult game. But certainly, Seamus had, four turnovers, and we were very frustrated from a Mayo perspective on that. Aidan, I think, pulled the trigger on another occasion, maybe going for glory when he could have recycled the ball.
He nearly hit the corner flag.
He did. It was a little bit reckless. You know, so we had opportunities. The theory circulating there, we had Mayo missed their chance. I don't think they have, Sean. I think we finished the game so strong. You mentioned the fact we were 5 points down at half-time. Within 3 or 4 minutes, we then whittled back to one. And then Dublin went ahead again by three. And again, we showed a great manliness and character to come back and equalise. So I think we finished it stronger. I think yesterday's performance will embellish our reputation as regards, well, this is not a team that's going to wilt under pressure. And I think Mayo will come out of that game an awful lot stronger than they went into it mentally.
3 weeks ago, Sean, we sat here and Jack O'Shea made a very relevant point. He wondered whether Dublin could come back up after the performance of the last day against Kerry. Would it 3 weeks or 2 weeks, would they be able to get back to the same level? But the same is now for Mayo. They played so well yesterday. Can they come back in 2 weeks' time and reproduce the same performance? We know the Dublin team played poorly yesterday, and we're still contesting an All-Ireland final in 2 weeks' time. And we will improve. We have to improve. We must improve, and we will improve. And we'll be better the next day. We'll be better prepared. Whatever team he puts out on that field will be a team that's determined to get the ball over the line. And the next day, I think we'll show a little bit better.
Yeah, well, chances are they'll have to put the ball in the net themselves the next day if they're going to get the two goals.
No, they gave us two goals yesterday. Surely they can improve and give us three the next day.
I don't know. What do you think, Orla? I mean, again, the if you like, the received wisdom is because of the dump.
はい、ここは、トラモアから、ウエストコースの幹線25号線国道25号ずっと走りまして、ダンガーバンです。非常にここはね、食事が美味しくていいレストランもいっぱいあるんですけども、とにかくこの起伏の激しい緩やかな丘がこう一面に広がるウエストコースでもなかなかない素敵な景勝地、ダンガーバンです。コークとウォーターフォードのちょうど中間ぐらいにあるのかな、ダンガーバン。これからこの丘陵を登ってコークの方に向かいます。ウォーターフォードからダンガーバンに到着。
The freshness about Mayo though, Sean, like, I mean, we lost our current championship to Galway, but it's been an incremental improvement, albeit not playing top tier Division 1 teams and also on the route to the final. So I think we've seen an incremental improvement. I think this Mayo team are fresher than Dublin. Dublin are trying to do something, you know, they're on the cusp of greatness, putting back to back Ireland finals. I think the pressure is beginning to play on them a little bit. I think some of those Dublin forwards are beginning to wilt, a lot of football played, like some of the Kerry players. So I think there's a freshness about Mayo. The 2 week break will do a lot of good to us, so I think we'll be ready for action in 2 weeks' time.
Damien?
Yeah, I love the mental strength that the players showed yesterday. Like, Dean Rock was replaced in halftime last year's All-Ireland final, and it looked like he was maybe struggling a bit yesterday with the conditions and the free taking. His frees were a bit further out than he'd usually put over with that sort of weather. Andy Moore was making great runs inside, wasn't working out for him, but Dean Rock regained his composure and he didn't let the game get away from him. And Andy Moore came out and launched a revival for Mayo in the second half. And in fairness to Aidan O'Shea, he started very deep, he wasn't working for him, he came out and got involved a bit more. And it's fascinating to see these players refusing to yield on the pitch, even though things aren't going for them, and even though the weather was horrible as well. But John Mon has just struck the first balls for the replay anyway. Looking forward to the mental games for
now. There's another issue here, and it doesn't require any partisanship to be shown or hinted, but it's a listener saying, Michael Clancy, kicking a GAA football is difficult as the design is ancient and in bad weather it's a real lottery. Martin Browning in the Independent has highlighted this very issue. He says, this listener Michael says, soccer balls are always being redesigned and improved upon. In wet weather, a GAA ball is heavy, slippy and very hard to kick. Is that still the case, John?
I don't think so. I don't know how you can redesign the football, to be quite honest with you. I don't know what kind of redesign
that. Round is round.
Round is round.
Well, round to go, round. No, the ball doesn't get any heavier. That's in all the known myth. In the old days, it does get slippy. And we saw that yesterday. Even guys who were referred to earlier, going into contact with the ball was slipping out. And when you see that happening, and when you see the little Dermot Connolly falling to the ground three times and tried to get up, you know, it came out very shortly after the Minor match. I was on Twitter, the Minor guys were saying that the surface wasn't treacherous, but it was like, oh yeah, you never saw that very, very quickly.
It's very hard to hold your feet in Croke Park. The modern surface obviously is top class, but with a drop of rain, very, very slippery. You never see a divot in Croke Park.
Somebody made a great point to me afterwards. He said, they knew the rain was on the way. They knew it was going to be at game time. So they not let the grass grow a little bit longer and give a little bit more traction.
Well, that was a late forecast for Charlie.
Oh, we had a clue in the week.
Right, a word about the Miners. I met Martin Yule, a famous Galway footballer from the three in a row year of the 60s, after the Minor match. He says, you know, the bad news is, the word from Kerry is that next year's panel with this academy is even better than the one that won the three in a row yesterday.
Yeah, well, all accounts, and like, three in a row is huge, and I can just see what's happening. I think Eamon Fitzmaurice is going to have another 2 or 3 years in senior job, and I just get the feeling that Jack O'Connor is going to come with Declan O'Sullivan and take over this crop of minors at 21s and try and drive them on again. So I think Kerry, the future is bright for them. There's no
Jack is concerned in his piece this morning that they're being talked up too much too soon about minors.
Yeah, as Charlie mentioned, that's what we're talking about this off air about the academy down there, the conveyor belt, the cough up, the minors. Jack O'Shea did mention that the next year's team is exceptionally good, but Charlie mentioned can only play 15 at any given time, thankfully.
And have the academy in Tyrone as well, better than I think anyone, certainly in terms of the setting there in Garamani, I think it's called, or less than right. And these things, I carry around and catch up with the rest of the country.
And, you know, it's just taken me 21 years to catch up with this man here, Charlie Redmond. You know, now that you mentioned Tyrone, you know, we all love him so much after 95, and forgetting to go off that time.
Oh, well, then.
Certainly that was again, you did expect him to be left behind, but the game was called off to that extent. We were expecting him to have picked up a couple of points away from Zerba, but anyway, we'll wait and see what happens.
On the minority sports front, Marty, you spotted an important victory for an Irish tennis player.
Well, you know, I'm a big tennis fan, so the victories are rare enough, so it definitely needs to be highlighted today. Was James McGee, only becoming the third Irishman to win an ATP Challenger Tour title last night in America. I think, again, it's funny sport, you never know what's going to happen. He was supposed to be playing in a tournament in China, and he had visa problems, he wasn't able to go, so quite late in the day decided to go to this other tournament in North Carolina, and he ended up winning, I think, 8 games on the bounce to win that, and now he's catapulted himself into the top 200 in the world, so, well done to him.
And finally, the curtain down on the Olympics, the Paralympics ending last night in Rio, Charlie. Again, a lot of inspiring stories, not just from Irish athletes, but elsewhere as well.
Absolutely, because when you see what the athletes can achieve in the sport, I mean, when you think of what we've done at Croke Park yesterday, and we played them so badly, so what happened in the Olympics, it makes you believe in the human spirit and what's achievable for people.
Yeah, and Patrick Munnan from Kildare was the last Irish competitor, Sean, yesterday. He finished in the 54 Reacher Martin in 16th place, 1 hour and 40 minutes. And as you say, it's absolutely incredible, and Ireland's haul has been great this time around.
He was quite angry with himself, wasn't he, at the end of it? Yeah, I mean, he said if it wasn't his first Olympics, he would have pulled out early, because it was really tough with the conditions.
Of course it was, yeah. No, the Irish team have been a credit once more, and a huge media exposure as well, which is great to see.
Well, let's see what the homecoming is like. I'd say it's going to be quite embracing when they get back on Wednesday to Dublin Airport. Look, we leave it there for now. Just, sorry, last minute predictions. I think John, I'll tell you they are.
At 12 o'clock midday, as we pause for the Angelus. Thank you.
agus in isha nuach le padru cúlán. Gair maad rónan agus balaiari. Tá sé tukki le fys ag údarás da státi an tíhe gwyl pléas ele tárlaithe is da New Jersey. Marlon Flays le dín da fólí ní ibe a gíra bag baint dachar as gailis a fríu a musk a brúskir. Marlon Bafla is ele in New Aurach agus New Jersey a rihin tele seachtana. Hierin staat er nu het uiteindelijk uiteraard vrijheid dat al die lijst verhoudingen en schelle achter overlijst er heeft de etenslijnen aan, agus dat mag worden te goeien. Volgens hen kan over morgen moe geweest door kerkje kerkgemeente dingen hebben gegest. Gerard Rooney heeft met de maat 3 post, Edo Harrick heeft dit secret aan een FG post als een hele, morgen even een realtus en we halen een haalbaan. Dort Ned O'Hara go costas the most 3 plus to Gordo after it after staff a titum. Don't have for your best to hear a final plus ulta and as a bit fonter after session of father by Hill Realtors. Or Shem Realtors on Scar Halwood is moo and how you got us pushed. I can read down that you think here get for you in the national empty in the hour can you and I play in there over the top of the ask a lot of time when I was in the mid-key. Tien an na Canary, iarracht ar éan tuáil ar frá mouti a dasg ar as éidirvártiach da rinú fwy chaithir locht chaidiori gachuit na tíra seo agus na hirdaine a dús na bríana. Iol an tír seo ar mi bán fóbr seo gaita gynhlaach a dís le cherabíle tefach as an tíria ach níra trí chéad teag ag a dís seo. Bae an tánis de Francis Fitzgerald ag rinú mullet an leiniom ar cán na tíra seo. Tás é dearbhaigh de Gordaí go sé do mhaint fiosrithe faoi díomhan atá dianta gur dearnú éagnú ar áthar mrá le dín scrúdú d'éis a bheith gaidara in ospidéal príomhaid a Bansacúr i Dráilí don de Shiarraí. Rinne an bhean Clás Anois de Gordaí éan an lá ar dúrú rinneúin téagnú i dús na mísa seo. Cuir ú scrúdú ar a mbean in éanad ansaí ag néis in ospidéal a Gorca. Tá ráitis tógaí na Gordaí ón mbean atá os cíana leithéid. Agla Corofession ag na Gordaí ar hart an bhúis é nele san ospidéal. Agus an aimsir, lá bráid Teirin Green atá gealta i bhormhór na tíriniu, cés múite go chálmúr in seo agus an siúd. Hart ar chúg cén géad Celsius a bheis tóch na tíriniu. Agus le sin bhíon ag bí brís gealta na nuaita agus an aimsir fí láhar agus tá tíl a ganúch le fáil ar app RTE News Now.
はい、ここはウエストコーストでもなかなか綺麗な街ですよね。よーよー。そしてここからカウンティーコーク、ウォーターフォード県からカウンティーコーク、コーク県に入ります、まあ、夜は昔からのチャーチ、それからお城、まあ一種のちっちゃいこうフィッシングビレッジだったんですけども、アイルランド大飢饉の時も結構被害を受けた、壊滅した形跡というか遺構が結構ある場所ですよね。今は本当穏やかな海の街、週末は多くのツーリストに賑わう素敵な海辺の街、ちょっと神奈川の葉山に似てるかな、そんな感じです。コークに入ります。コーク県です。
all weekend, Godmother of Beloved and Mona Henry, formerly Ryanto Cottages, but in Belmont House in Stillorgan down the road. Hope you had a great weekend. I'm a major Dubs fan, so another chance to cheer next Saturday week. Best wishes to you from Liz. And also hi to Mum Evelyn Foxall from Dudley in West Midlands. Herself and Dad Alan, listen in all the time. Love the contact with home and with Ireland. Happy birthday to you, Evelyn, belatedly now, from Rob, Joan, Liam, Sean, and all the crew in Walkinstown. And I was asked if I'd include a song by Mary Platt. But always a welcome voice in the program. Family from someone who describes themselves as an everyday listener and brain candy with love.
Mary Black, singing Tom Moore's song. Down on my knees again, which I'm doing, apologising for not being able to recover. So many of those birthdays last Friday, including one from Mam, Ella Wilde, Wrexham Heights and Enniscorthy. Much love by our sons and daughters, Billy, Stephen, Davis, Marnie, and Mike.
also to Philip Townsend, who stranded the road in Sligo, from Mick Moran and Sarah, and Mam is Ann Burns of Sandyford in Dublin. Birthday today, a very happy birthday from Geraldine, Andrew, Emily and Liam. And a happy customer, Andrew, actually Andy Murray. Andy heard the programme on Friday and heard my mention of Dean Friedman appearing in Arthur's Pub on Thomas Street in Dublin on Saturday. He went along and he said it was a terrific night. The message line on your email said, thanks for the top off. And I was saying, what's this now? But in actual fact, in the script on the email then it says, thanks for the tip off. Glad you enjoyed it. Andy Dean Friedman the other night. Plenty more music on this Monday afternoon here on Radio 1 between now and 1.
The Rowan and Collins Show on RTE Radio 1.
Many of us believe we have life insurance, or we may just have mortgage cover. Protecting your home is important, but with VHI Life, you can help make sure your family will be financially supported should you die. VHI Life is life insurance made simple for only €21.39 a month. And VHI Healthcare members get a 10% discount. Call us on 1819-444-444 or search VHI Life.
€21.39 per month is based on a 37-year-old non-smoker for a 20-year term and cover of €200,000 and includes the 1% insurance levy. VHI Healthcare Limited, trading as VHI Healthcare, is regulated by the Central Bank of Ireland. VHI Healthcare is tied to Zurich Life Insurance PLC and VHI Lifetime Insurance. Terms and conditions apply.
Visit the 51st Annual Irish Antique Dealers Fair in the RDS this Friday to Sunday. See a vast range of the most beautiful antiques available in Ireland today, from jewellery and silver to furniture and paintings, also featuring 21st century design classics. Now is the time to buy with confidence. The Irish Antique Dealers Fair, this weekend in the RDS.
すいません、ちょっと停車してしまいました。ここヨールって街なんですけど、ここにビレッジグリーングローサー、ビレッジグリーングローサーっていう有名なパン屋さんがあって、多分アイルランドのウエスト国で一番うまいんじゃないかな。本当に美味しいソーダブレッドとケーキ売ってて、どうしてもちょっと家に帰っていきたくてちょっと停車しました。出発いたします。すいません。
Army while we're in St. Louis. What should we be doing? Do you know what I mean? Your family just people out of touch. But what hits you first isn't the aircon, sat-nav, or cruise control. No, the most striking thing about the Clio is the APR on finance. Because it's zero. 0% APR. Get down to your local dealer before September 30th for 0% APR on a brand new Renault Clio. Renault, passion for life. Spec standard from Dynamic. Trim level. Finance is made under a higher purchase agreement. Terms and conditions apply. Deposit required. Subject to lending criteria. See Renault.ie.
はい、ここがいわゆるジェームソン、アイリッシュウイスキー、アイリッシュウイスキーで有名なジェームソンのミドルトン、蒸留所ありますけれども、ちょっと今過ぎちゃったんですけど、右に曲がってすぐのところにジェームソンのディストリーがあります。いわゆる日本でよくも飲まれているジェームソンウイスキーの、ホームというところで、ミドルトンベイリエーラーっていうのがいわゆる有名で秀逸なブランドですけど、北県のミドルトンです。
The end of the night is thickening. A cloud arrives in the west coast. That'll bring drizzle there later. Temperatures overnight down to between 7 and 10 degrees. And then tomorrow, an increasingly cloudy day. That drizzle extending into the western half of the country, probably thickening up into rain. It'll be sunny in the east to start. Well, brighter anyway, but it'll cloud up there too later on. Temperatures similar there, maybe a degree higher tomorrow, about 15 to 17 degrees. That's the general forecast. Now here's the sea area forecast for the next 24 hours, starting with the meteorological situation at 9 a.m. A ridge of high pressure over the country today will decline and will be replaced by a southwest flow tonight. Forecasts for coasts from Fairhead to Howth Head to Mizzen Head and for the Irish Sea. Wind north to northeast, force 4, decreasing force 2 or 3 this evening and becoming variable or southwest force 2 or 3. Weather's mainly fair and the visibility is good. Forecasts for Irish coastal waters from Mizzen Head to Slinehead to Fairhead. Wind southwest, force 3 or 4, increasing force 4 or 5 tomorrow forenoon. Weather mainly fair today, cloudy with patchy rain drizzle tonight and tomorrow. And visibility is good, at first moderate in rain or drizzle from tonight. An outlook for a further 24 hours until midday on Wednesday. Moderate to fresh south to southwest winds increasing strong along Atlantic coasts on Tuesday evening. Rising to near gale or gale in the west by Wednesday morning. The rain will become persistent in the west overnight on Tuesday, spreading eastwards on Wednesday, and visibility will become moderate to pour in the heavier rain. And now the coastal reports at noon. Malin Head, southwest 9 knots, cloudy 21 miles, 1025, rising slowly. The Boyd M5, north-northwest, 14 knots, wave height 1.5 metres. The visibility at Tusker Lighthouse is greater than 10 miles, 1026, rising slowly. Roaches Point, north 10 knots, cloudy 18 miles, 1026, steady. Valentia West, 4 knots, cloudy 18 miles, 1027, steady. Belmullet, southwest 11 knots, cloudy 11 miles, 1025, steady. And finally, Dublin Airport, northwest 7 knots, cloudy 16 miles, 1026, steady. That's the forecast. Good afternoon.
Thank you, Joanna Donnelly at Met Erin, and welcome back from their honeymoon, Rosalind Martin and her new husband, Rory Sweeney. Many congratulations from Limi Boo, Rosalind's favourite man, and Rosie, who apparently is not a favourite of Rory's, or may well be. But Rosie is the dog. Jim and Rose Daly, meanwhile, have their anniversary today. 50 years of great happiness and love for each other. Congratulations, say Orna, Stephen, Brian, Orla, Barry and Mark. And hi to Tim and Sinead Carey. Happy anniversary to you in Dunleary. Mary McAvoy and Mary Kate, writing from Bray in County Wicklow, want you included on the programme. And Phil and Brian in the Wee County celebrate their 25th wedding anniversary today. Many congratulations and love from one to the other. And 17 years, say Johnny and Edith Nugent of Malahide in County Dublin. Lots of love to you from Helen and daughters Molly and Carrie and all friends and the extended family. And a golden wedding anniversary greetings to TJ and Teresa Heenan of Windsor, just north of Castlebar, town in County Mayo, says Tony in River Valley in Swords in Dublin. Congratulations. Here's a lady who was born on this day back in 1941. The great voice.
Tears of Mama Cass.
お待たせしました。コークシティ、コークに戻ってまいりました。コークの中心部、コーク県の中心、コーク。前走ってるバスは多分あのミドルトンのジェームソンのバス、ツアーバスだね。パッケージでバスと入場完了で結構安いシャトルバス、ジェームソンのバス。あ、なんか今日はシップが入ってますね。左側大きい船が入ってます。国交なんで、うちの親が昔国交とかで日本、あのここ漁港でもあるんで、面白い船入ってますね。通訳の仕事やってたんでよくここ来ましたけど、綺麗なとこですよね。コークポート、ポートオブコーク、コークです。
Trial at the Children's Court, charged with the false imprisonment of former Taoiseach John Burton and her advisor, Karen O'Connell, in November 2014. The prosecution alleges the boy was involved in trapping both women in two Garda vehicles for 2 to 3 hours.
Top of star quality, Heineken. Heineken も最近メジャーですよね、アイルランドでは。あ、まあ会社の関係もあると思うんだけど。親会社が結構ね、お酒の会社を結構買収してますからね。 フランスの国旗つけてますね。フランスからの気象船ですかね、これ。ピエ。ネイビーなのかな。思いっきりジェームソンバス。あっちもない。ここがバスアラス、コークのバスステーション。右側、13時の方向。その向かいがダンズストア。アイルランドの唯一の、まあ、随一の庶民スーパー。パンツが安いんで、ここよくパンツ買いますけど。右側がバスアラス、バスステーション、コークのバスステーション。
It also found one in four people admits to not meeting the information that comes with their medicine.Our health correspondent for flowers, along with over-the-counter medicines. Millions of prescribed drugs are dispensed each year by pharmacists. A new survey by the Health Products Regulatory Authority has found that one in eight people has taken a prescription medicine not prescribed for them. That is over 400,000 people. Also, one in four people admits not reading the information that comes with their medicine. This represents over 800,000 people.And the authority says the number is increasing when compared with previous studies. The authority launched a campaign today for the safe and effective use of both over-the-counter and prescribed medicines. Its chief executive, Lorraine Nolan, said people need to inform themselves about the correct dose, directions for use, and known side effects of medicines. The authority says that significant details, such as the contraindications or potential side effects, can change from time to time. So it is important that those...
とにかくダブリンもそうだけど、アイルランドは一通ワンウェイが多いんで、例えば行きたい方に行こうと思ったら実は一通で行けなかったって時、焦んないでもうそのまま流れに沿って大回りしていくのが一番いいですよ。そこで焦るとよく事故っちゃうんで、本当アイルランドはワンウェイが多い。特に都市部、ゴールウェイもそう、コークもそう、めちゃくちゃ多いっすよ。
Time to discuss issues affecting refugees and migrants. At the special UN summit, leaders will endeavor to agree a set of proposals arising from negotiations, which diplomats from Ireland and Jordan co-chaired earlier this year. From New York, our Washington correspondent Katrina Perry.
There are more than 21 million refugees in the world, half of them children, more than at any time since World War II.Today's UN Summit on Refugees and Migrants aims to formulate a global plan It's the first time world leaders will focus their efforts on this subject. Earlier this year, a draft document of proposals was agreed by countries following negotiations led by Ireland and Jordan. However, many frontline agencies dealing with refugees and migrants, including Oxfam Ireland and TROCRA, have warned that the proposals don't go far enough. Last September, the Irish government committed to accepting 4,000 Syrian refugees, but so far just over 300 have arrived. Cornish Sir Francis Fitzgerald will represent the Irish government at today's special summit. Katrina Perry, RTE News, New York.
Now the time is coming up to 1:08.
RTE Radio 1 weather with Aer Lingus. With direct flights to Hartford, Connecticut launching this September, when Smart wants to discover New England, Smart flies Aer Lingus.
A mix of cloud and sunshine today, and just isolated light showers. Highest temperatures 14 to 16 degrees in mostly light breezes. Onya.
Brian, thank you. And still to come on the news at 1, the Children's Court trial of a 17-year-old charged with false imprisonment of former Thornishton Joan Burton. To appear or not to appear, PAC Chairman Sean Fleming says Michael Noonan will be asked to answer key questions about NAMA before this committee, but the minister gives us a statement saying he'll review the invite, but it's not normal practice. The FBI names a suspect as five more devices are found in a backpack at a New Jersey train station and blown up. Can the United Nations find some solution to the global refugee crisis? A warm September, but grain farmers in the West face losing up to half their harvest and they want government to act. And is there any chance that the buses will be running for the All-Ireland replay? No, says the NBRU, and we'll hear why. Those stories and more coming up on the News at 1 after this break.
An efficient history of energy efficiency. People think coal, oil and natural gas will last forever. They realise that might not be the case. Energy efficiency becomes a matter of national and international importance.